Monroe, Virginia, San Steve, you're way behind time. This is not 38, but it's old 97. You must put her in Spencer on time. Then he looked around and said to his black, greasy fireman, just shovel on a little more coal.
Now you can see we've got a pretty good tan. We've got a better tan than the people down here have.
That's right. They look pale.
But you notice how we blend right into those people down there? I can see how that woman made a mistake when I moved, you know.
Yeah, tell us that story.
You'll have to tell that story.
Teresa Brasher said she was driving by and looking at it, admiring all the people in it, and suddenly one of the people that was in the painting moved and turned around, and it was you. Those characters you painted were so vivid and lifelike, she thought you were part of it. Just for the people that don't know, you painted the original train painting that was up there.
Painted the original from a ladder. It was in the winter. I started like in October and finished in January of the following year, of 04.
Oh my gosh. Did you have any cold weather that you had to contend?
Oh, yes. Yeah. A lot of cold weather.
Were you up there painting while it was cold?
Well, it has to get pretty cold for me to quit. But I started it, I guess, in 2003, in October, then I finished it in 2004, January.
Okay. So it lasted almost 20 years.
Yeah, 19 years, I guess.
But you didn't design that one, right?
No, I didn't do the sketch on that, the original sketch. Sherry Lee, she got that from a lady somewhere, but I don't remember who it was.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd always give her credit for that. I didn't do the sketch, you know. I stayed pretty well with the sketch.
Did you?
And the perspective, it was terrible getting that perspective because it came to such a vanishing point, you know.
Well, tell us about that. How hard is it doing? Because perspective is a big determining factor in whether a piece of art is good or bad. Perspective's hard to deal with when you're working on a scale that's in
that's exactly
30,
right.
40 feet.
You can't see, so I'd have to go over to the farmer's bank. At that time, I'd run across the street and look at it from the bank. Now, don't try that now.
You run over?
You will. It's hard to get across the street now.
You can see from up here, it's hard to tell what you're doing. So how did you do that? How did you transfer that image to the wall then?
I did it with pounce patterns and by just drawing with a yardstick, the way I remember it.
Okay, now pouncing.
A pounce pattern is you take paper, you draw your picture out, and then you run over it with a wheel that perforates that paper. Then you put that on the wall and you take a bag of powder, be it black or white, which you need, and transfer the drawing to the wall.
But then that train that you painted, though, it was 20 feet long.
Well, now, I didn't make a pattern for the entire train. I just make a pattern like for the wheels, and the more intricate parts of the train I made a pattern for, and I'd put the other end with a yardstick, you know, draw the other end with a yardstick.
Right. The original painting was up there, and of course it became iconic for the city. Anybody would say, well, where's Parsons? Oh, you know where that train painting is. And it was up there for years and years and years. But then it started fading and peeling off the wall. And finally, we twisted your arm and convinced you to do another painting.
Well, I didn't think, there was times when I didn't think I could do that. Then I got to thinking if I could have somebody to help. And that's where you came in. and some way of getting up on that wall. And Mr. Wayne Lyles, he solved our problem there when he got a hold of that lift that we used.
How much nicer was it painting off that lift instead of off that extension ladder?
200%.
And it wasn't easy on the lift.
Right, right. It was not easy, but it made it a whole lot better. A whole lot better. You go right where you wanted to go.
Now tell us how, now when you went up that ladder.
I would take a gallon bucket and put three colors, three small cans, and I would paint out those two cans and just run one color into another, never clean the brush.
Yeah.
And then when I started on something else, I'd have to go back down and get different colors and put my bucket in it.
Oh my gosh. I could imagine at the end of that experience, you were like, woo, Thank goodness that's over. I don't have to do that again.
Hardest job I've ever done. But this time, this was hard. It's a lot more complicated picture. But the conditions, other than being hot and miserable, the conditions were good.
This painting, this plan, was all yours, your design, your concept. When did you start working on that?
That would have been winter before last, I guess. And we worked on it and changed it and revised it. And there's been 100 drawings done, little thumbnail drawings, and that brought us up to where we are, was ready to go on the wall.
Your design, the way we put this up here, is we use grids, and that's how you measure it out. You had everything to scale in your sketch.
I think the way I had that scale was 3/8 inch equal to foot, which was a little bit hard to keep up with.
How long have we spent laying that out? It took us
a good while.
It's just hard to paint something, to do anything artistically to something that big when you're that close to it, you know?
You can't see it. All you see is the part you're, little parts you're painting. It may not relate with the parts you just painted.
Yeah. So a lot of our days were painting a little while and then coming down and looking.
Exactly. And that, it may be hard to understand how that works, but that's the way it worked for us. Now, it may be a different deal with someone else, but that's how we did it.
Yeah, we started doing this in April. Is that when it was?
Yes, just probably the 15th or a little after.
Yeah, middle of April.
Yeah, and we worked. I remember keeping up with the days we worked. We worked 11 days in May, and we had a pretty good June there. We worked several. Some weeks we worked as high as 4 days,
mm-hmm.
but then the rain got us on and later on there, and we was working a day or two or a half a day, and it drawn out. If you put it all together, it wouldn't be near as long as it seemed there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I would have to stop mow the yards. I mow all my yards there, and so 2 days a week, a lot of time, was all we worked. But all in all, it didn't go all that bad.
No, I think we were blessed with the weather in May and June. It never got too hot during those months.
Right. Good days, we just had to watch for the rain.
Yeah.
Occasionally, we'd go all the way up here, see what the weather was doing.
And occasionally, it would be bad.
Yeah. But luckily, we had plenty of warning.
Yeah.
July, it rained the first day, and old-timers would say it rained 15 days. I think it rained more than that during July.
It did. I think you're right.
And that first picture, that was done mostly with, painted mostly with oil-based paint. And this picture was done with acrylic, which oil-based, over the years, has got, it don't hold up as well. So acrylic holds up a lot longer.
Yeah, and the colors are so vivid, and just to watch you get up there, you're so bold with your colors. Like, you were painting those mortar lines in the brick one day, and you got in the shadows, and you know, if I'd done that, I'd be like, well, this mortar, it's light gray, it's just got to be darker gray. So I would have added black to it and put it in there, and you painted it blue, and by God, it looks amazing.
That was blue on black that were faded into the shadow.
Yeah, it looks so good. You're just fearless with colors. Have you always been good with colors?
I think I've improved. I've, you know, studied color a little more as I got older. No, to answer your question, no. I hadn't always been that good with colors, and I still have a lot of room to go.
The way you did it, I know if you're traveling west on 412, man, that thing, it looks like there's a train busted out of the wall over there, you know?
Well, I hope it does.
It's so vivid. Now, what was the idea? You have integrated this Parsons history. Literally, it looks like it's literally inside the wall. And that was all your idea to integrate it that way.
Yeah, it was my idea. Now, I could say a car hit that wall down there, and the front wall, and ran through it, and that gave me that idea. But that wouldn't be correct.
It's just coincidence?
That was a coincidence, yeah.
Well, it looks like it's a portal to another dimension.
Well, that's a little heavy for me, but...
Now, I've noticed, you know, you love brick. How many walls have you painted brick on that weren't brick?
Well, I don't know that I've painted. Well, the old mural in Decatur had brick around the old furnace. I painted a picture of the old furnace up there, and it had brick. And then around my place, I've painted brick, you know. And I had a job one time that I thought I was going to have to paint some brick on, and I practiced on the wall of my place I work out of down there.
The perspective is all painted on the wall there.
Right.
That's awesome.
And then the job fell through, so I learned a little about brick there, you know. But it's hard to paint brick.
That's a lot of brick.
The key to painting brick is to make them look like they're not painted.
You have studied the intricacies of brick in ways that...
Well, I hope so.
But, you know, those bricks, if I was making bricks again, I'd make them all the same color and everything, but they're not. They're like you painted them. You got a dark brick over here and a purple brick over there. And
especially the old brick looked like that, the antique brick. You know.
Have you ever done any brick laying?
I've done amateur brick laying. You wouldn't call me nowhere near a pro.
Okay.
But I know the mechanics of it.
Is it harder to paint or to lay?
Oh, I think I could lay them easier than
And you know, an interesting story. Remember, you had been painting that brick for a few days, and all of a sudden we showed up one morning, and there was a real pile of brick
right, laying
there on the ground in front of it.
And we don't know where they came from.
Did you manifest that brick?
I didn't manifest them, no.
It's weird. It just showed up.
But another thing we did is we tried to do an A-model truck. Loaded across that.
Say, don't you know me?
Yeah.
I'm your native son.
Look how pretty that is.
And just in 2 days, an A-model truck came driving down the road, around the highway there.
You're absolutely right. Like, you manifested that as well. If we see a train coming down the road...
Better move over.
Look at all those colors in there.
Tell us about that A-model. Now, that's a part of your own personal history, isn't it? Doesn't that have ties to your own past?
Yeah, I can remember that. Yes, my folks, they would work the timber hand-hewed cross ties, make them by hand, and then they'd make a load. My daddy would make a load of cross ties, 40 cross ties, and have somebody haul them for him to the depot at Camden.
Uh-huh.
And I figured they might haul cross ties to this depot, too.
I'm sure. How much was a load of cross ties back then?
It seemed to me like he'd get $40.
$40?
$40. The guy that hauled them would get $6. The guy that drove the truck and hauled them and my daddy would have to load these cross ties. That was a job, you know.
I bet.
I hear the train.
And so you were born in 39, and the railroad shut down when?
36.
So you just missed that.
Yeah, I missed it for 3 years.
But I'm sure you had no idea that painting trains would be so much of your life later.
Well, I don't think it crossed my mind much.
Now, as an artist, I've been telling people lately, you just, art oozes out of you. Everything you do, there's art. I've got a note on my desk you left on my door several months ago, and it's got a horse head drawn on it. You were working on that horse head in this painting, and it made it to one of these notes you left on my door. So everywhere you go, there's art. You just leave it behind. Why are you an artist? Do you know where that comes from?
I don't know. I started that when I was young, like 4 or 5 years old, and just tried to improve a little as I went along. And there have been a lot of years I didn't paint, you know, a lot of years I didn't paint anything. But if I work on something like that, well, that's what's on my mind, and I'm trying to improve. When I sit down, I'm still thinking about it, so I do a little sketch. This might look better. You know.
Yeah. Something about engaging with the arts, you know, it just kind of pushes everything else out.
That's very true. And that's pretty hard to explain to anybody.
Yeah. You know, my fear is that, you know, in this modern world where you've got so many conveniences, you've got all these little gadgets to eat up all your spare time, you know, I'm afraid that we're going to lose a lot of artists who get lost playing with their phone instead of expressing themselves.
That's true, but there's also the potential of learning from those gadgets. You can learn about anything you think of. You can look it up and get an idea on how to do it if you go at it from that direction.
That's true. That's a better way to look at it. Yeah. I bet I'd move it on a little farther down the line. We've gotten a lot of support out there on that.
We have. Yeah. The highway supported us. I'll say that.
There were horns honking.
And thumbs up. And great job. It's really something.
It's uplifting. It makes you feel good.
Well, yeah. It's got to make you feel good.
Now, a lot of people are wondering, are these historical figures you painted in here on this painting?
The only historical figure is Toby, I guess.
Who's this guy over here?
This is Toby over here. And he's watching that train, you see. He's more or less mesmerized with that train.
The people who are driving by can't see all the picture if they're driving in front of the picture. So I put a street scene in. I painted the street scene in. I thought would be of interest there.
Yeah.
And so none of the figures are really historic, but beside Toby, you see a guy, probably his wife and a little boy. Now, they're probably foreign people. That was my idea.
Uh-huh.
And the gentleman there that's got, I think he may be a part-time lawyer. He's got a part-time law practice, and he sells insurance on the side, so he's pushing a little insurance there. Now, that was just my thoughts.
Now, the dog, there's a big story behind the dog, isn't there?
Yeah, that's Toby's dog.
Yeah.
Toby's dog. His name's Falwell.
Yeah.
And he's a rabid dog, but he's intimidated by fire hydrants. You know, most dogs are not. And he carried him hunting at one time or another, so Toby said. But a rabbit whipped him pretty bad, and that pretty well ended his hunting. So now all he does is lay around. And then Toby said he thought that was a little hard on him.
So the dog's confidence is shook.
It's shattered, yes.
And Toby, I guess he's out doing some shopping.
Toby's got a bag of flour on his shoulder and a sack of potatoes there. He's mesmerized by that train. And the little boy seems to be mesmerized by Toby.
And that flour, what's that flour company?
That's a division of the Diversion Company. Bake Right Flour.
Bake Right Flour is a division of the Diversion Company?
That's the best I can come up with.
Now that woman, that's a pretty woman. She's got a pretty face.
Well, the guy there, that farm guy, is probably lucky to have her. But she don't seem to be into that insurance deal there, you know.
No, doesn't seem to be interested.
And the guy that they're trying to sell to, he doesn't seem to be into it too much either.
He does have a faraway look in his eyes,
yes,
doesn't he?
He does. He's looking like the Nashville Memphis.
You don't think he's going to sign that document he's holding?
I don't think so. He's holding it, but he's looking out on the street or somewhere there.
Just waiting for this to be over?
Yes, I think so.
Who's driving that train?
I don't know who that is.
Now, people say he resembles somebody.
Yeah, I think they do.
I wonder who they think he resembles.
Well, different people think he resembles different people, you know. But
I can't be pinned down on that.
You know, as a Parsons citizen, I feel very lucky to have been able to watch you create this piece of art.
Well, I'm lucky to have your help there. I don't know how I'd have made it without you.
We had a good time up there, didn't we?
Had a good time. We didn't have no incidents.
I think I know all your favorite songs, and You know all my favorite songs?
I think so. We kind of traded some information there that we hope no one heard.
But I sure enjoyed being up there with you.
I did too. I enjoyed the whole project, and it was hard, but most things are, you know.
Oh, yeah. When you signed this painting, you called it what?
The Last Picture Show.
You're not going to do this again in 20 years?
No, I don't think so.
It's going to fade.
I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it again next week.
Anything else you want to talk about?
No, nothing.
Okay.